Dear friends, I am Dr. K. Kannan, Professor Mechanical Engineering, Anjaliyammal Mahalingam Engineering College, Kovilvendi. I am happy to meet you again through this video lecture series on the subject heat and mass transfer. So this is for the undergraduate mechanical engineering students. And the subject is heat and mass transfer. This is module number 4, heat exchanger. So we are going to discuss the heat exchanger, lecture number 1. So here we discuss in this lecture the heat exchanger, the types of heat exchanger, and the LMTD method of designing a heat exchanger, thermal design of a heat exchanger. So we recap the previous lecture. In the previous lectures, we discussed the conduction heat transfer and the convection heat transfer. And in the heat exchanger, what we are going to discuss, these two modes are predominant, conduction and the convection heat transfer. There are heat exchangers with the radiation mode, which is not we are going to deal with. So we are going to discuss or solve the problem on the heat exchanger, where the conduction and the convection modes of heat transfers are involved. And at the end of the lecture, the student will be able to define heat exchanger. You will be able to explain what are the different types of heat exchanger. And you should be able to discuss the LMTD method for the design of the heat exchanger. Heat exchanger is a device which is used to transfer heat from one fluid to another fluid by virtue of temperature difference. So exchanging heat between the two fluids, that is what a heat exchanger. So obviously one fluid will be the hot fluid, another fluid will be the cold fluid. Always the heat is transferred from your hot fluid to the cold fluid. Heat exchanger is a device which is used to transfer heat from a high temperature fluid to a low temperature fluid. That is what the definition of the heat exchanger. Then how to classify, what are the different types of heat exchanger available, and we try to group them into different category. The first category based on the types of the fluid flow arrangement. The heat exchanger may be a parallel flow heat exchanger, counter flow heat exchanger, or cross flow heat exchanger based on the fluid flow arrangement. And look at this diagram. The first diagram is the parallel flow heat exchanger, second diagram is the counter flow heat exchanger, and the third diagram is the cross flow heat exchanger. So look at this diagram. So here the red color line is the hot fluid, black color line is the cold fluid. And we have a heat exchanger here. So there is a tube where the hot fluid is flowing from the left side to the right side. There is another tube, larger diameter. So the cold fluid is flowing in the annular space between the larger diameter and the smaller diameter tube. So there is a space between the two tubes. This is called as annular space, and the fluid is flowing through the annular space. The cold fluid again enters on the left side and leaving on the right side. And look at the temperature profile of the hot and the cold fluid. So from the entrance to the exit, the temperature of the hot fluid is decreasing, whereas for the cold fluid, from entrance to exit, the temperature is increasing. So the heat is given by the hot fluid and absorbed by the cold fluid, so that there is variation in the temperature. So here, both the hot and the cold fluid, they are flowing in the same direction. That is why it is called as parallel flow heat exchanger. Look at the second type, counter flow heat exchanger. A similar type of heat exchanger we have taken. And now there is no change in the direction of the hot fluid. Hot fluid enters on the left side and leaves on the right side. Whereas now the whole cold fluid enters on the right side and flows in the opposite direction of the hot fluid and leaves on the left side. So the two fluids, they are flowing in the opposite direction. That is why it is called as counter flow heat exchanger. And look at the temperature profile here, the hot fluid temperature is decreasing from inlet to the exit, and the cold fluid temperature is increasing from inlet to the exit. So look at the temperature profile, arrangement of the temperature profile. So hot fluid temperature decreases and cold fluid temperature increases. So here the cold fluid enters and leaves on the other side. So here the hot fluid enters and leaves on the other side. And look at the cross flow heat exchanger. So we have a heat exchanger, cold fluid entering at the top, leaving at the bottom, and the hot fluid is entering at the left side and leaving on the right side. So here the flow direction, they are perpendicular to each other. The cross flow heat exchanger, the flow directions are perpendicular to each other. So flow directions parallel, the same direction, there is parallel flow heat exchanger. Opposite direction, this is counter flow heat exchanger. Perpendicular direction, this is the cross flow heat exchanger. And based on the heat transfer process, the heat exchanger may be direct contact heat exchanger, indirect contact heat exchanger. What is direct contact heat exchanger? Suppose you want to, you have a hot water ready for your bath. You want to reduce the temperature. So normally what we do, we mix some cold water with the hot water. So there is direct contact between the hot and the cold fluid, and that is why it is called as direct contact heat exchanger. In the indirect contact heat exchanger, the hot and the cold fluids are separated by a metal surface. There is no direct contact between hot and the cold fluid. All the heat exchanger, they are indirect contact heat exchanger. So what we are going to design, they are indirect contact heat exchanger. Based on the construction type, the heat exchanger may be tubular heat exchanger, plate type heat exchanger, tube fin heat exchanger, plate to fin heat exchanger, shell and tube heat exchanger, and the regenerative heat exchanger. So we will see one by one. And based on the heat transfer mechanism, this may be single phase forced or the free convection heat exchanger. So single phase, both in the hot fluid and the cold fluid, they are in the single phase. What do you mean by that? It may be in the gaseous phase from entry to exit, or it may be in the liquid phase from entry to exit. So the fluid, hot fluid and the cold fluid, from inlet to the exit, they are in the single phase, either liquid phase or the gaseous phase. There are other heat exchangers, special type of heat exchanger, where the phase change is taking place. For example, a boiler, evaporator, and condenser. So in a boiler, the water is heated up and converted into steam. And in the condensation process, the vapor is condensed and converted into liquid. So that is also a type of heat transfer, boiler and the condenser. And radiation combined convection are the radiation. So the specific mechanism. So when in the heat transfer, if the radiation is involved, that is also possible in the space heat exchanger, where the radiation is predominant mode of heat transfer. It is single phase heat exchanger, phase change heat exchanger, and radiation mode of heat exchanger. And another method of classifying the heat exchanger is compactness. Compactness is defined as the ratio of heat transfer surface area to the volume. So the overall area available for the heat transfer process divided by the volume of the heat exchanger. Normally volume of the heat exchanger equal to multiplying the three dimensions in the case of a rectangular type. That is what the volume and total heat transfer area. So when this ratio is greater than 700 meter square per meter cube, the heat exchanger is referred as compact heat exchanger. When the area, surface area, heat transfer area divided by the volume, when this ratio is greater than 700 meters per meter cube, then it is called as compact heat exchanger. The automobile radiator is an example for the compact heat exchanger, wherein the compactness is approximately 1100 meters square per meter cube. Just to visualize the automobile heat exchanger, the total heat transfer area is very, very high comparing with the overall volume of the heat exchanger, overall volume of the radiator. That is compact heat exchanger. Based on the application, the heat exchanger may be boiler, condenser, evaporator, regenerator, cooling tower, heater, or the cooler. So whatever the application, right? So based on the application. So these are all the different methods of classifying the heat exchanger. And this is an example of a shell and tube heat exchanger. Look at the diagram. We have a shell, the cover shell, and the shell side fluid is entering here and leaving on the other side. There is another opening, so the fluid will be leaving on the other side. And inside the shell, we have a number of tubes, tube bundle. The tube, so it runs from the left side to right side and it takes a turn and flows again from the right side to left side. Now the fluid in the tube side, they enters here and flow through the bottom side of the tubes, flows from the left side to right side and take a turn and flows in the upper side of the tubes and leaves on the other side. This is called as header. So inlet of the tube side fluid, outlet of the tube side fluid, and here inlet of the shell side fluid, and there is going to be another opening for the shell side fluid which will be leaving on the other side. This is the example for shell and tube heat exchanger. And again, another example for shell and tube heat exchanger. Here the tube side fluid is entering here. The green color line that indicates the tubes. The fluids are flowing through the tube from the left side to right side and collect at the right side and flows down, flows to the other operation. Now the shell side fluid, it enters here, and the blue color line that indicates the flow of the shell side fluid, maybe the hot gases. There are baffle plates. The purpose of the baffle plates is to deflect the fluid so that the hot fluid will be retained inside the heat exchanger for a longer time for more heat transfer between hot and the cold fluid. So having the baffle plate here, length of the heat transfer path is increasing. So there will be more heat transfer, maximum heat transfer between the hot and the cold fluid. This is again example for shell and tube heat exchanger. And this is another example for shell and tube heat exchanger. So the single pass. So single pass shell and tube heat exchanger. So the tube fluid is entering here and flowing from the right side to left side, and it is leaving on the other side. And shell fluid is entering here, and we have the baffle plates. So the fluids are flowing in the direction of the arrowhead and leaves on the other side. So this is again shell and tube heat exchanger. This is plate type of heat exchanger where we have the vertical plates. And the red color line indicates the hot fluid, and dark blue color line indicates the cold fluid, and the blue color line indicates the cold fluid. So red color line, hot fluid enters here, there are opening, and the fluids are flowing alternative gap. So there is the first plate, second plate, third plate, fourth plate, fifth plate, like that. We have number of vertical plates. The hot and the cold fluid, they are flowing in the gap, in the adjacent gap, alternative gap between the plates, and the heat is transferred between the hot and the cold fluid. And this is a cross flow heat exchanger with the fins. So this is also a cross flow heat exchanger with the fins. This is, look at here, these are all the fins. So the inclusion of the fins here, that will increase the heat transfer area. So the heat, what is the purpose of the fin? It will improve the, it will increase the heat transfer area so that we may have better or more heat transfer, heat exchange between the hot and the cold fluid. And this is again a plate type of heat exchanger. So red color line for the hot fluid and blue color line for the cold fluid, and they are flowing in the adjacent alternative gap between the plates. And this is the profile, temperature profile of a boiler. So what is boiler or the evaporator? So in the evaporator, the water, saturated water is entering, and the water is heated up and the steam is leaving on the other side. So for conversion of water into steam, the fluid temperature is constant. So look at the boiling fluid temperature of the boiling fluid, this is constant. The hot fluid, hot gases are entering and leaving on the other side. So the temperature of the hot gas are decreasing. So hot gas are entering with a higher temperature and it decreases, temperature decreases. So the decrease in temperature is transferred to the water, which is converted into steam. So for the fluid, which is fluid, for the fluid where the phase change takes place, the temperature is constant. So for during the phase change process, the temperature is constant and the heat given to the fluid that is used to increase the latent heat. So that is called as latent heat of evaporation. So this is the temperature profile for a boiler. Similarly, a condenser. The steam is entering in the condenser and the steam is cooled and converted into condensate, so which is liquid. Here, the cold water is circulated and the temperature of the cold water is increasing. So, once again, look at here, the hot fluid is the steam which is converted into liquid. So, the condensate temperature, the temperature of the condensing fluid is constant and the cold water enters at the lower temperature. It absorbs the heat energy from the steam and the temperature is increasing and leaves with a higher temperature. So, the water temperature is increasing. For the condensing fluid, the temperature remains constant. And for the heat exchanger, so normally we design a heat exchanger where the two fluids are separated by a metal surface. And look at, we just consider a pipe of circular cross section. Fluid is flowing inside. Fluid is flowing inside. Because of the fluid flow, there will be convection heat transfer between the fluid and the inside metal surface. And there is fluid flowing outside. Again, there is convection heat transfer between the fluid and the surface, outer surface. We assume hot gas are flowing outside, cold water is flowing inside. So the heat from the hot gases, they are given to the outer surface of the tube. And across the thickness of the wall, there is conduction and heat is conducted. And again, it is converted to the cold fluid. So, there are three heat transfer. The heat is transferred from the hot gases to the outer metal wall by convection heat transfer. And across the metal surface, it is conduction heat transfer. And again, from the inner surface of the tube to the fluid inside, it is again convection heat transfer. So, the three heat transfer and we have three different resistances for the heat transfer. So, the first resistance, convection resistance inside, which is 1 by AiHi. So, Ai is the inside area, Hi is the inside heat transfer coefficient. And the conduction resistance across the metal surface, which is T by K into Am. So, T is the thickness of the wall and K is the thermal conductivity of the material and Am is the mean area. And the convection resistance outside, so which is 1 by HO into AO. So, AO is the outside surface area and HO is the outside heat transfer coefficient. So, here the inside resistance 1 by AiHi, conduction resistance across the metal surface T by K into AM and the convection resistance outside which is 1 by AO into HV. And based on the three resistances, we calculate the total resistance, which is R equal to 1 by AiHi plus T by K into AM plus 1 by AOHO. This is the total resistance for the heat transfer between the hot fluid and the cold fluid. And here the AM is the logarithmic mean area, which is AO minus AI divided by logarithmic of AO by AI. So, AO is the outside surface area, AI is the inside surface area of the tube of particular diameter and the length. And based on the resistances, we have to calculate the overall heat transfer coefficient based on the inside area. So, Ui equal to 1 by Ai Ri. So, you just substitute Ai Ri. So, Ar we have calculated earlier. So, this is what the R. Based on the inside area, we have to multiply by Ai. So, this is what we have done here. So, 1 by R into Ai. So, substituting for R, we will get this value. And the Ai in terms of radius, this is Ri by K in logarithmic of Ro by Ri plus Ri by Ro 1 by HO. This is what the Ui based on the inside area. Overall heat transfer coefficient based on the inside area. Similarly, outside area. So, Uo equal to based on the heat transfer coefficient based on the outside area. So, Uo equal to 1 by AOR. Again, substituting and simplifying, this will be 1 by RO by RI 1 by HI plus RO by K logarithmic of RO by RA plus 1 by AHO. That is what the overall heat transfer coefficient based on the outside area. So we will be referring to, we will be using the overall heat transfer coefficient for the heat exchanger. In the heat exchanger design, 99% the value will be given. So U value will be given. So do not worry about this equation. Even if the value is not given, we can calculate with a simplified equation. So you remember the terminology, overall heat transfer coefficient, which involves the inside heat transfer resistance, conduction resistance, and the outside heat transfer convection resistance. So that there are three resistances, they are combined and put together, they are called as overall heat transfer coefficient. And if there are fouling due to the age of the heat exchanger, due to the continuous use of the heat exchanger, there will be some deposition of the material on the tube side, inside of the tube or outside of the tube. So based on the deposition, the overall heat transfer resistance will increase because it will add some additional resistance for the heat transfer process. So that also we have to consider. So fouling, when the fouling is given, we have to include the fouling in the overall resistance. So R becomes 1 by AIHI plus Fi by AI. Fi is the inside fouling resistance and AI is the inside area. And this is the conduction resistance, plus FO by AO, that is outside fouling resistance divided by AO, and this is the outside convection resistance. And this is another example for the fouling. So this is corrosion fouling, the fouling of the material, fouling during the heat exchanger due to the corrosion, and this is biological fouling because of the deposition. The fluid is flowing inside the heat exchanger because there will be some deposit on the surface, that is what called as biological fouling. And based on the previous lectures, we just recall the various points what we discussed earlier. So in the previous 20 minutes discussion, what are all the points you remember? Just to write down, you take few seconds and write down the points. You can even give a pause to the video and write down the points. So if you are able to write all these points, parallel flow heat exchanger, counter flow heat exchanger, cross flow heat exchanger, shell and tube heat exchanger, plate type heat exchanger, boiler, condenser, overall heat transfer coefficient, fouling factor, corrosion in the heat exchanger surface, etc. It is good. It is only to recollect the point. Do not think over. We just, what do you remember from the previous 20 minutes lecture? That is what we want. So you have to carefully listen. That is what the objective. You have to carefully listen to the lecture and take hints if required, and note down the important points if required. That is what the idea of the reflection spot. So the design of heat exchanger, there are two methods. One is LMTD method and effectiveness NTU method. So in this lecture, we'll discuss the LMTD method. And in the next lecture, we will discuss the effectiveness NTU method. So in the LMTD method, these are all the different terminologies. MC and MH, mass flow of the cold and the hot fluid. CPC and CPH, specific heat of the cold and the hot fluid. THI and THO, hot fluid inlet and the outlet temperature. TCI and TCO, cold fluid inlet and the outlet temperature. So all the properties, mass flow rate, specific heat, and inlet and the outlet temperature. The philosophy for the LMTD method or heat exchanger design, the heat gained by the cold fluid is equal to heat lost by the hot fluid. Very simple. So heat gained by the cold fluid, that is equal to heat lost by the hot fluid. So what is the heat gained by the cold fluid? MCP into TCO minus TCI. So MCCPC into TCO minus TCI, which is equal to MHCPH THI minus THO. That is what the heat transfer in the heat exchange. And you have to calculate the heat transfer area. So heat transfer is also given by Q equal to UA into LMTD. So U is the overall heat transfer coefficient, A is the surface area, and LMTD is the logarithmic mean temperature difference in degree Celsius or Kelvin. So we discussed the overall heat transfer coefficient. Remember, the value will be directly given, and area is the heat transfer area, LMTD, logarithmic mean temperature difference, that is what we have to calculate. So look at the parallel flow heat exchanger. We take the parallel flow heat exchanger. So we have the, we discussed the parallel flow heat exchanger earlier. Both the fluid are entering in the same left side and leaving on the right side. So look at the temperature, TCI, cold flow inlet temperature, TCO, cold flow outlet temperature, THI, hot flow inlet temperature, and THO, hot fluid outlet temperature. And here I calculate delta TO, that is temperature difference for the heat transfer, entry of the heat exchanger. 0 stands for entry of the heat exchanger, L stands for exit or the length of the heat exchanger. So 0 length and full length of the heat exchanger. So here left side 0 length of the heat exchanger, right side full length of the heat exchanger. So delta TO here, THI minus TCI. Delta TL equal to THO minus TC. So temperature difference on the left side, temperature difference on the right side. Very simple. Temperature difference on the left side, THI minus TCI. Temperature difference on the right side, THO minus TCO. Then the LMTD for parallel flow heat exchanger, delta TO minus delta TL divided by logarithmic of delta TO divided by delta TL. So this is what the LMTD. And this equation is also available in your data book. You need not mug up the equation, but you should know how to use the data book equation. Equation given in the data. Then counter flow heat exchanger, the similar expression. Expressions is the same. LMTD equal to delta TO minus delta TL divided by logarithmic of delta TO minus delta TL. But the thing is, the difference is delta TO and delta TL. Now look at the temperature profile, THI, THO, TCI, TCO. Now delta TO equal to THI minus TCO and delta TL equal to THO minus TCI. That is what the difference. Then you can calculate the LMTD for counter flow heat exchanger. There are heat exchanger other than simple parallel flow, counter flow heat exchanger. And now for all the other types of heat exchanger, we are going to calculate LMTD. For all the other type of heat exchanger, we use the correction factor. So Q is equal to U into A into F into LMTD, where F is the correction factor. LMTD is the logarithmic mean temperature difference based on the counter flow configuration. And here, to calculate F, the correction factor, for various arrangements to be obtained from the chart based on the R and the P value. Where P equal to TCO minus TCA divided by THI minus TCA. So the numerator TCO minus TCA is the heat gain, temperature increase of the cold fluid, and THI minus TCA is the maximum possible temperature difference in the heat exchanger. So in the data book, it is given as T2 minus T1, small T2 minus small T1 divided by capital T1 minus small T1. Here, capital T stands for the hot fluid and the small t stands for the cold fluid, 1 for the inlet and 2 for the outlet. So, this way you have to remember, hot fluid inlet temperature, cold fluid inlet temperature, and numerator is cold fluid outlet temperature minus cold fluid inlet temperature. And R equal to THI minus THO, that is temperature decrease of the hot fluid divided by temperature increase of the cold fluid. So TCO minus TCI. So capital T1 minus capital T2 divided by small T2 minus small T. That is what the R value. So based on the P and R value, we have to find out the correction factor for various arrangements. And this is the first heat exchanger. It is on page number 159 of your Hidden Masters data book. And this is for single shell, one shell pass, two, four or multiple tube passes. There is only one shell and any number of tube passes. And look at the config, look at the diagram. The P value on the X axis, correction factor is on the Y axis, and there are different lines based on the R value. So knowing the P and the R value, you can calculate the correction factor. Similarly, page number 160 on your data book, hidden mass transfer data book, this is for two shell and multiple tube passes. Two shell, 4, 8 and multiple tube passes. Once again, P in the x-axis, correction factor is on the y-axis, R value, there are different lines for the R. And this is for cross flow heat exchanger. One fluid is mixed, another fluid is unmixed. So the based on the configuration, the lower temperature T1 is the cold fluid inlet temperature, T2 is the cold fluid outlet temperature. We have the horizontal lines, that means the cold fluid is flowing through the pipe and the hot fluid is flowing outside the pipe. So the fluid which is flowing inside the pipe, they are unmixed. The hot fluid which is flowing outside the tube, they are mixed. So the hot fluid is mixed and the cold fluid is unmixed. So here the page number 161 in your data book, hidden mass transfer data book, and once again P is in the x-axis, R is on the different lines, and you will get the correction factor. And this is correction factor for both the fluid unmixed. So we have the both fluid, they are flowing in the finned passage. So you will have both the fluid unmixed. The radiator is the best example for both the fluid unmixed. Automobile radiator is the example. It is available on the page number 162. So P is on the x-axis, R value for different lines, and correction factor you can calculate from the data. And these are the reference book for the subject. So for further information, you can refer to these, refer to the 5 books, whatever is convenient to you. And this is what the book what I have published earlier, and you may find a lot of examples from the Anna University question paper published by the Anuradha publication, Chennai. And for any clarification or doubt, you can write to me to my mail ID. I will sincerely answer to all your queries. Thank you, and meet again.